Hi, thanks for watching. This is the official 2024 non-technical winter field day overview brought to you by the Ulster and Northern Dutchess Readiness Group of New York. My name is Steve and my amateur radio call sign is K2GOG. So winter field day is an annual event which promotes communications readiness using amateur radio technologies and spectrum. This takes place the last weekend of January every year from Saturday 2 p.m. local time to Sunday 2 p.m. local time. This is a 24-hour long event. Not everyone participates for the full time, but it is a 24-hour continuous event, should you wish to make it that way. It's also a fantastic opportunity to blend multiple things together, such as outdoor activities and amateur radio. I like to call this convergence, and I think it's a great way to inspire more activity in this unique hobby. So where will you find Winter Field Day activity? There's a nice interactive map on the official event organization's website, www.winterfieldday.org. Not all sites are public. Some are listed as private, and you can see that easily on the map. Those with the blue snowflake are considered public, and the purple ones are considered private. Anyone can visit a public Winter Field Day site. You do not need to have an amateur radio license. If by chance you do wish to try making a radio contact, you can do so under the supervision of licensed amateurs. And if you don't want to get out there in the cold weather, if it will be cold in your part of the country during the event, you could also listen in to activity via internet-connected radios found on websites such as www.websdr.org. This is also a great way to start listening to amateur radio before the event if you're just curious what we're talking about on a daily basis. And if you do decide to visit one of the public or private sites, I would highly encourage you to reach out to the organizers in advance. Ask if there's anything that you can bring, or ask any other questions. So this way you have a good idea as to what to expect. Pretty much anyone who's operating and planning a Winter Field Day site has a clear plan, and they usually try to avoid surprises. So in order to prevent anyone's feelings from getting hurt, again, I would encourage you to reach out to organizers if you're planning to offer something relative to the event itself. So here are some examples of what to expect at a real public Winter Field Day site. There should be somebody who is available to answer questions. So the photo in the upper right is myself talking to a couple people in 2023 walking their dog at Minnewaska State Park. And I think I was demonstrating Morse code at that time. So there's usually going to be somebody at a public site available to answer questions. There's also going to be amateur radio operators, most likely wearing headphones. They're not trying to ignore anybody. They're just looking to make radio contact and avoid any outside distractions. So just be mindful of who's doing what and when at a Winter Field Day site that is open to the public. Anytime that you do engage an amateur radio operator in conversation, we're a pretty enthusiastic group. So just be prepared. You might get a long answer or get into a really nice conversation with somebody. So just keep an eye on your watch if you need to keep on moving wherever you're headed next. And we're just like everybody else, so feel free to stop by, visit any of the Winter Field Day sites. The more people that visit are always appreciated. So I would highly encourage you, if there is a local public Winter Field Day site, to definitely feel free just to stop by, even if it's just for a few moments. So here's some pre-event stuff related to Winter Field Day. This is not just a cold weather event. It happens all across North America, including all those warm states like Arizona and Florida. Sometimes it's a nice little joke to exchange local temperatures. Nobody's cheating. It's still Winter Field Day. It's still about outside preparedness, but those in the colder country states and provinces tend to really put a lot of effort into it. Throughout the presentation, by the way, you'll see this little orange fox popping up. So feel free to keep track of how many times that you see the fox, and this will help you absorb a little bit more details from this great presentation. So everybody who participates within Winterfield Day is grouped by a classification. This year there's four, but in past years there's been three. So the first one, and I'll go into details and about these later. So there's outside, inside, home, and mobile, which is new for this year, which I'm very excited about. So if you are going to be participating or even just creating your own little mini Winterfield Day, it's a good idea to practice ahead of time. Know what radio and other equipment that you're going to be using, and also start figuring out your food and beverage situation to keep you going as a person. And any of the real deep details you could read about on the winterfieldday.org website, which has all the official rules for 2024. And the good news is, if you have operated as something like Parks on the Air or Summits on the Air, which are two great outside amateur activities that happen throughout the year, if you've done either of those, you're most likely ready for Winterfield Day. So please, be part of the event if you're looking for a new challenge, if you enjoy things like POTA and SOTA. So here's what a typical voice conversation would look like during the event. It's important to listen first and hear how contacts are being made. So in this case, I'm contacting a station with the call sign KB3EFS. Typically you say CQ Winterfield Day. You might repeat it a couple times, but say CQ Winterfield Day. This is K2GOG operating 3 Oscar in ENY QRZ. So all that's conveying is my location, which is ENY. 3 Oscar is my operating class and number of transmitters. And QRZ is a short abbreviation for is anyone actually listening. So then Dave, KB3EFS, replies back. He calls my call sign, and then he shares his operating situation as one hotel. And he's in Western New York with the phonetics Whiskey November Yankee QSL, the shorthand for confirm. I confirm it, and then I just wish them good luck in the contest. So that's a pretty standard voice contact. If you're doing things in Morse code, it's certainly going to sound very different, just a series of dits and dahs or dots and dashes, whichever you prefer. And with all the modes, you can use different levels of power to get additional points. So feel free, again, check out the rules for this year to maximize your enjoyment and following the rules, especially as it comes to some of the digital modes. So you can do keyboard to keyboard type of communications, which is pretty fun if you're not a Morse code aficionado or you have some mic fright in public. Digital modes are great, but not all of them are permitted in the event. So be sure to check out the official rules. And in any type of contact, using logging software on a computer makes things really easy to keep track of. You don't have to worry about a piece of paper that you wrote everything down on blowing away. And that's also a great idea as it relates to multitasking, to use headphones or a headset to free up your hands for typing. And again, I've already mentioned this enough. There's a number of different changes for this year, including something pretty cool. There are some additional objectives which offer some bonus points. So feel free to check those out and ensure that you capture those extra points during Winterfield Day 2024. So let's go through what does it mean to be outside, inside, home, and mobile. So an outside station is everything is off-grid and temporary. You can see at the picture at left, everything was carted out on a sled. Looks like they have a solar panel, a temporary tripod-based antenna, a tent, and even what looks to be a small little wood stove inside to keep the operators warm. So that's a pretty cool setup. And again, everything is easy deployable, it's temporary, and everything is off-grid. Here's the official definition, which I will not read, but everything is pretty clear in terms of what constitutes an outdoor station. You will need to make sure that you have good power for your radios. Again, if you're operating 24 hours, you will need the ability to run during day and night. So top off your batteries during the day so you have ample power throughout the night. And also be sure to have food and water so you can keep yourself powered up as well. Everyone counts for Winter Field Day, but outside participants are extra special. If you hear them, work them. They've most likely put a lot of effort into their operation, and they would appreciate the extra contacts. So looking at a inside Winter Field Day operation, it's kind of almost like playing radio as normal with a few differences. And so looking at the photo at right, this is a great example of somebody who has set themselves up in their detached garage, which is detailed over in the definition. A detached garage has a permanent foundation and some good insulation. So that is a location that would count as an inside. And there's not as many insides as you'd think. So it's kind of a little rare. So feel free, set yourself up if you have a outbuilding, a shed, a garage, you know, whatever that would be considered a an inside location per the definition. And you might be surprised. You might be seeked out, and feel free to invite your friends over. You know, it would be great to hear a five India type of station instead of just a one India as an example. And then let's look at home. So this is just plain radio as normal. Nothing special. You can see it's a very small definition. It goes as far as making sure that it's clear that you have to be within 500 feet of your home, regardless of operating inside or out. So this is what constitutes a home station. Everybody who participates in Winter Field Day for 2024 is limited to 100 watts. That's including home stations. So to challenge yourself, maybe try running lower power so you can get extra points, or maybe even, you know, try running on some kind of emergency power, or maybe a temporary antenna. So there are some ways that you can change things around. If you're at home, you can maybe convert yourself into an inside station if needed, while still being at home, technically. Every contact is great. I like to get as many contacts as I can possibly do. Everyone counts. But please, if you're a home operator using a great antenna, please try to give priority to those that are doing a Winter Field Day outside or from a mobile, as an example. And again, everybody counts for Winter Field Day. I cannot stress this enough. If there's some reason that prevents you from visiting a site or hopping in your car and going mobile, please get on the air. The more contacts, the better. It makes it more enjoyable for everybody. So if you will be at home, you know, please even just find a few minutes just to make a few contacts. We'd all appreciate it as part of the event. And new for 2023, if you're going to be sitting in your car or your truck, you are a mobile station. And the picture at right is a great example of a pretty cool mobile setup. The person looks like they've driven onto maybe a lake or a field next to a playground, and they were smart to deploy an antenna such as a delta loop. Most likely this is for a 20 meter band. It's a really fantastic antenna. This one looks like it's made by Chameleon Antennas. You can easily also make one of these out of some parts that you might have around the house. So it's a really cool antenna. And the key thing is with a mobile installation, this means that the vehicle has to get to the location and get back from the location on its own power. If you're trailing a trailer with an external antenna, that's still considered mobile because it got there connected to a vehicle. So be sure to look at the rules of what constitutes a mobile station, since this is new for 2024. And if you're somebody who is involved in parks on the air and you do that from the car, this year you can officially participate in Winter Field Day as a mobile station. So I'm really looking forward to hearing as many familiar POTA voices on the air for Winter Field Day. So you know, please familiarize yourselves with the rules. This is a great way to show that the event has expanded. So here's some tips for success no matter what. I cannot stress enough, contacts are contacts, but only when they're logged and count for Winter Field Day. So be sure that you know what you're going to be exchanging with others if you're new to Winter Field Day. So first thing is, what operating class will you be? So use common phonetics. Outside is Oscar, inside is India, home is hotel, and mobile is Mike. So make sure that you're using the correct phonetics and know what operating class you're going to be. Secondly, if you're going to be running multiple transmitters, such as part of a club or multi-person operation outside, once you set your number, you should not change it. So if you have three different transmitters, one for, let's say, 20, 40, and 80 meters, or 15, 20, and 40, whatever. So that means that you have three stations and you're also getting a multiplier. So the more that you can have on the air at the same time is a major benefit. So try to challenge yourselves and your friends to deploy as large of a setup as possible. But again, once you set that number, you got to keep it the same. So just be mindful of that. Even if you just make one contact on one band, that counts as an extra transmitter. So again, challenge yourself if you have extra capabilities. It's also really important to know what call sign you're going to be using. If you're going to be operating as part of a club, they might be using somebody else's call sign for everybody. So make sure you know what that is so you don't accidentally use your call sign. Instead, use the official one before you pick up the mic or send it with your gear. You're also going to need to communicate where you're located. This event uses the ARRL sections. You can learn more about the ARRL at their website, ARRL.org. Here's how this works. It's a short two or three letter acronym. I will be located in East New York, so my acronym is ENY. I'm talking to somebody in Texas. Where in Texas? North Texas, Western Texas, or South Texas? All the different sections are listed, so make sure you know what your section is and also how to say it phonetically. Every contact is really important. Log your contacts accurately the first time, every time. And there's lots of great logging software that you can do this with. Pictured over at right, at bottom right, is by far the most popular program for Winter Field Day by N3FJP. It's a great piece of software. It only runs on Windows. So if you're a Linux person, you also have some other options available to you, such as the N1MM, which is not pictured, as well as something that's been around for a few years, but not as well used. I personally like it just because I like the style of it by K6GTE. And these are all purpose specific for Winter Field Day. So feel free to check these out ahead of time so you can get familiar with how these programs work before Winter Field Day. So here are some tips if you're going to be operating outside for the first time. Plan on either having one larger battery, such as a lithium polymer, or maybe even a few smaller. If you're going to be operating for a full 24 hours, I would suggest something at least 60 amp hours or better, depending on your power output. If you're running lower power, you might be able to get by with a 20 amp hour. The benefit of having a few smaller batteries is you could have one in use while the other's charging. So give that a thought about how you want to do this. If you are in a colder part of the country, try to keep your battery warm. LiPo batteries don't always like the cold weather. So even if it's just put it in a warm sock or something, try to keep it a little warmer. You'll get some more power output out of it. And if you have solar panels, keep it charged up during the day. So this way you could run the battery fully topped up once it gets a little bit into the evening and late morning. And most importantly, if you're going to be locating yourself at a portable location as an outside station, you may be needing to avoid gas powered generators. Not every location allows them without a permit, so please be sure to check. Last thing you want is having a local law enforcement or park official come over to you and ask you to leave, and now you won't have the ability to play radio since there was no batteries. So be sure to look at what you will be using to power your radios. Secondly, I would suggest trying to run separate power for your radio and computer used for logging. This just offers you some extra flexibility and resilience for your station. So again, try to think about how you're going to power everything and also make sure that you update your computer and install any software before the event starts. You don't want to be scrambling around at the last minute. If you're going to be operating with others, try to find out who's overseeing logging. Chances are if somebody's running four Oscar or five Oscar, you know, four or five stations. They may have a little network set up where computers can connect to each other and make sure that you avoid duplicate contacts with everyone else. So be sure to ask about that if you're going to be participating with others. As it relates to antennas, I would say try to avoid using zip ties. Do not over tighten them. If you have to cut a zip tie off at the end of the event, you don't want to leave little bits of plastic behind at a park. So instead, maybe try to use reusable hook and loop fasteners. They also tend to not freeze as easy, and you could reuse them. So those are really great. You could typically pick up a 50 pack of those for a few dollars. So I've converted to using those. In Winterfield, they also sometimes moisture has a nasty habit of getting in places where it shouldn't. So even though this is a temporary event, depending on your type of antenna, even just wrapping some electrical tape around an antenna connector is a good idea just to prevent some moisture from getting in to your antenna and maybe changing your SWR or efficiency of your antenna. And if it is looking to be a little wet in your area, try to incorporate drip loops where needed. So this way, water does not wick down your coax or wick down an antenna into a feed line. If you're going to be operating outside, maybe at a park bench that's made out of wood, it's very easy to lose your body heat. So look into an insulated seat cushion. You could typically go to most outdoor stores. They sell these towards like Hunters and Fishers for, you know, about $10, $15. They do a really great job of helping you avoid heat loss. So that's a good thing to look into. Plus, it also makes it a little bit more comfortable for you to sit for longer amounts of time. And then also, if your feet are going to be on the ground, you will lose heat there. So try to keep them elevated slightly or put some type of an insulator underneath your feet. So this way, your feet don't get cold. And make sure that you're wearing the appropriate layers depending on the weather. So you can always take and remove layers. Try to keep them loose. So, you know, look into wearing the appropriate clothing and hand coverings to stay warm. And you're also going to want to stay hydrated. If you do plan to work the 24-hour full event, make sure you take care of yourself. You want to be productive as a radio operator and not dozing off or asking people to repeat their location or details on the other end. So just be careful about what you drink. Having hot coffee sounds like a good idea, but it will dehydrate you. So even just having water or something with mixed in electrolytes would actually be more helpful. And overall, just be safe, especially if you're going to be out at night, use a flashlight. And if you're going to be operating with others, keep things sanitary if you're going to be sharing radios. So if you have to make one of those dreaded 2 a.m. bathroom breaks to a tree because you're at a park or something, or an outside location, make sure that you're keeping everything clean, especially if you're going to be sharing equipment with others. And that's pretty much it. Again, thank you so much for the time. And if you were wondering about the UNDR Group, this year we'll be operating from Minnewaska State Park here in New York. It's POTA K5326. It's kind of rare, so hopefully we'll give people a lot of contacts. We'll be there from about 10 o'clock in the morning to just before Winterfield Day starts at 2 p.m., playing parks on the air. So feel free to, you know, look for us on the bands. We'll be probably running under either the N2HVD call sign or personal call signs. And then since the park closes around 5, we've been asked to start securing our location around 4. So we'll really only have a few hours to operate as part of Winterfield Day. Our goal is 4 Oscar. So we will try to make as many contacts as possible. But that's our plan. It's just going to be on Saturday. We're not going to be there on Sunday. And if you want to look for more details about us and other locations, you can look for that on the winterfieldday.org website, as well as to learn a little bit more about UNDR Group at UNDR-group.com. Thanks, and hopefully you have a enjoyable Winterfield Day.